lives. Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker.
Just have the attention of the members before we go to committee membership and other matters. I just have a statement to make. As members will be aware, on Monday, the Manager of Opposition Business raised, as a matter of privilege, whether the member for Pearce had failed to comply with the resolution of the House regarding the registration of members' interests, such as would constitute a contempt of the House. I'm satisfied that the Manager of Opposition Business has raised the matter at the earliest opportunity. The Manager of Opposition Business tabled a number of related documents, and I have examined these as well as his statement to the House. The matter arises from an alteration made by the member for Pearce to his statement of interests on 13 September of 2021. As recorded in the Register of Members' Interest, this alteration addresses payments related to a defamation case in the court. In the alteration, the member lists, quote, part contribution to the payment of my fees by a blind trust known as the Legal Services Trust. As a potential beneficiary, I have no access to information about the conduct and funding of the trust. The Manager of Opposition Business claims that by not including detail as to the source of the donated funds in his statement of interest, the member for Pearce has deliberately evaded the purpose of the register. I also note that while the member for Pearce made a public statement on 19 September about obtaining information from the trustee of the Legal Services Trust, that information did not include detail as to the source of the donated funds. The House has several rules about the pecuniary interests of members in standing orders and the resolution for the registration of members' interests. In 1986, the House provided that certain behaviours in relation to registration of members' interests would be included as a category of contempt of the House. Since the passage of the Parliamentary Privileges Act in 1987, Section 4 of that Act provides the test which applies to consideration of all contempts. The registration of members' interests is, in its nature, a disclosure regime, and transparency is a key feature. All members of this House would be familiar with their obligations in relation to completing and maintaining a statement of registrable interests, and the fact that these obligations require them to exercise their judgment about the disclosures. The explanatory notes published by the Committee of Privileges and Members' Interests state, and I quote, "The purpose of the Statement of Registrable Interests form is to place on the public record members' interests which may conflict or may be seen to conflict with their public duty." The notes also state as guidance, "No form can cover all possible circumstances, and members should consequently bear in mind the purpose and spirit of the return in deciding which matters should be registered." Based on my careful consideration of all of the information available to me, I am satisfied that a prima facie case has been made out, and I'm willing to give precedence to a motion concerning privilege or contempt as raised by the Manager of Opposition Business, referring the matter to the Committee of Privileges and Members' Interests. As members would also be aware, and as House of Representatives practice makes clear, an opinion by the Speaker that a prima facie case has been made out does not imply a conclusion that a breach of privilege or contempt has occurred. In giving precedence for a motion to be moved, I'm simply allowing the House the opportunity to consider a motion immediately and debate and decide on whether the matter should be referred to the committee for inquiry and report. And I now call the Manager of Opposition Business.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. I move that the following matter be referred to the Committee of Privileges and Members' Interests. not been many occasions where privileges references have been made, but in every instance, when you have decided to not give precedence, the House has accepted that and no suspension has been moved. And where you have given precedence, the House has then resolved to send the matter to the Privileges Committee. And I urge the House to do exactly that today. In doing so, the House is not making a decision, and I'm not wanting members opposite to feel that they are being asked to adjudicate on the member for Pearce himself. But they are in a situation where the Speaker, elected unopposed, has said that there is a prima facie case here. And the resolution allows the Committee of Privileges to examine the merits of this. Now, what they would be examining is no small matter. We have here not the sort of blind trust that members have used previously. There have been a number of times where members have come to this Parliament having already in their lives amassed considerable wealth. Good on them. No problem with that. And they want to make sure they avoid conflicts of interest, so therefore they put their money into a trust and they have, and someone else handles where the investments go. And up until now, that has been what we have dealt with in the register when we have dealt with a blind trust. The member may not have known where the money was being invested, but we knew exactly whose money it was. On this occasion, we are dealing with something that, if it is allowed to stand, if you are allowed to do this, we may as well not have a register of members' interests at all. Like, the term blind trust is being used. This is a brown paper bag stitched together by lawyers. We have no idea whose money is involved. If we accept what the member for Pearce has said publicly, we know the first thing. He can find out where the money has come from, because he was able to say it's not foreign donors and it's no one on the lobbyist register. So he has made clear that he can find out whose money this is, in this trust, for which he has personally benefited for a personal bill. So he can find out who it is, and he has chosen not to. And in choosing not to, he wants us to allow a situation to stand where the register of members' interests does not allow the public to know who gives us money. Now think about it. Think about the purpose of having a register. The whole reason it's there is so the public know if a member of Parliament gets money, the public have a right to know where that money has come from. What the member for Pearce has done, and there is a prima facie case of this, and the Privileges Committee will get the chance to examine it if this is carried. What the member for Pearce has done is something that no one else in this House has tried on.
Since Federation,
no member of Parliament has tried this. That you can receive income and not let anyone know who was paying. Now, the concept that he has no idea, I've got to say I have difficulty with, to think that there are philanthropists out there who could fund any charity in the world. And they look around for the different funds at a time of a pandemic, there's plenty of need out there, and they say, well, of all the different causes, the one I want to give money to is the legal bills of the member for Pearce, but I don't want him to know that I ever gave a cent. And somehow I've found out that this secret trust exists. Now, we're meant to believe that if we're to believe that the member for Pearce has no idea at all. But just start with this simple principle. Why do we have a register? Now, if you don't believe in having a register of members' interests, vote against this. I get that. If you don't believe members of Parliament should be held to any standards, vote against this. But if you believe that the public have a right to know where money comes from, if it comes to us,
then allow the Privileges Committee to examine it. I don't know what they will find. There have been a number of times when precedence has been granted, and I thought, yep, we've got there, and it's come back without an answer that I thought was great. But that's their job. And as a parliament, we've appointed people to the Privileges Committee to do that job. And sometimes, regardless of party affiliation, those members on that Privileges Committee have taken their job seriously, have taken their integrity of that role seriously, and have voted contrary to what might otherwise be considered party lines. The classic example of that would be Bruce Bilson. The classic example. Where I made the reference, precedence was given, it went through unopposed, and we ended up with a unanimous decision coming back from the Privileges Committee, and then the resolution was carried unanimously through the House. That's how matters of integrity should be dealt with. And that's what this House is now being asked to consider again. If we're not going to refer the member for Pearce, think about what's then allowed. Any member of this House can then set up a blind trust and have whatever income they want go into it, receive the money, and all they have to say is, I got it from the trust. Don't know where the money came from. Now, if we start with a principle that disclosure is there to avoid corruption, that the disclosure, the register is there to avoid corruption, that we want to avoid conflicts of interest to avoid corruption, then we need to oppose a system where members of parliament can keep secret who is giving them money for personal bills. Now, if you wonder whether is this just a Labor issue, remember the extent to which those opposite railed against a Labor senator who disclosed where he had money come from because it was to pay for a personal bill and because of the source of where that money had come from. He's no longer a member of parliament and left because of that. Now, if you think that was a reasonable prosecution of the facts right now, the member for Pearce is wanting to create a situation where those facts would never be known. Where anyone can just set up a trust and it doesn't matter what business interest, what potential criminal interest, what potential overseas interest gives you money, all you have to report is I got the money from the trust. Now, no one has ever tried this before. Not because no one had cause to possibly think of it, probably some people had, but everyone just knew it would be outrageous. We've all known that to do something like this, to say, oh, someone gave me a wad of cash, don't know who they were, but yeah, got it, good on me. We've known you're not meant to do that. And yet the person who had previously in this House been the Attorney General of Australia and had charged for introducing the anti-corruption body is the person who has set this up. And so I simply ask everybody when this comes to a vote to think of the way members have voted previously when they have taken their role on the Privileges Committee itself. Because on that committee, they have always acted with integrity and responsibly, and they have said they owe a duty to the Parliament. Well, we all do. And this vote is a test of that. Because if this is allowed to stand, the register of members' interests is obliterated in terms of being a disclosure document. The concept that we find out what the conflicts of interest are for members of parliament is obliterated. The concept that we have mechanisms in place to avoid conflicts of interest and corruption is gone. That's the decision that's in front of this House now. Now, the Privileges Committee might come back with an answer I don't expect. That's on them. But it would be the cover-up to end all cover-ups if this House prevents the Privileges Committee from even being able to look at this resolution before us. If all they are allowed to look at was the letter that's been sent to them by the Shadow Attorney-General, without the authority of it being a resolution of the House, it means they deal with it differently. The only time the Privileges Committee has an obligation to report back is when the information gets to them by a resolution of this House. So everybody here at different points have made speeches about integrity. Everyone in this House has made speeches about standards. This resolution is a test of whether or not we hold to the exact words that on different occasions every one of us has uttered.
And I think just before I call the Leader of the House, I think I need to just state the question, presuming the question is that the motion move be disagreed to. Are expensive, and we note that particularly when a member of parliament
supplies that flow through a vehicle. There's no transparency as to where that money has been donated from, for the Labor Party then to donate that money onto the Member of Parliament. No, there's no transparency, Mr. Speaker. There's no transparency in that process. And on the GoFundMe page, where Senator Hanson-Young, for example, and it's a very interesting study, or Senator Bob Brown, or others, Mr. Speaker, who have raised money, in relation to Senator Hanson-Young, which goes to exactly the points being made by the member for Watson about transparency in this issue. The donors to Senator Hanson-Young on a GoFundMe page included Mr. A. Non, N-O-N, or otherwise known as Anon. There was a John 5188-4010. There was a Mary W. There was an Anna B. There was a Buzz Rainbow Wolf. There was a Jeff CB. There was an Ann 559, a series of other numbers ending in 85. There was Xander B. There was MG. There was Steph Steph. There was Dave C. There was Bin H. There was Nikki. There was ET. ET donated. And Leanne W. Now, Mr. Speaker, I suggest to you that there is no transparency in that process. In fact, it makes a mockery of a suggestion that through the GoFundMe page, that is a transparent process.
Members on my left.
That donors are properly identified in their contribution to a Member of Parliament to provide support to them in a defamation proceeding. That's the reality, Mr. Speaker. And so the principle espoused by the member for Watson is not as virtuous as he might make out. So there is, Mr. Speaker. So I can go to the member for Hunter, who has an issue in relation to this, but I don't intend Leader of the Opposition, because I appreciate the spirit in which the opposition member has approached this matter. I don't intend to conduct character assessments of those opposite, because the point I'm making here is that I think this gives rise to a much bigger issue, in relation to members of Parliament. And that is why on Monday of this week, Mr. Speaker, I wrote to the Chair of the Privileges Committee, and I understand that the Shadow Attorney General has also written to that committee, because I believe that there are further issues beyond this which need to be considered by the Privileges Committee. I'm happy to, in a moment, table that letter that I wrote to the Privileges Committee to Mr. Broadbent, and I will make sure, Mr. Speaker, that members are able to view that, because I think, and I've detailed this in my letter, that there are bigger considerations and further considerations than those raised in the motion before the House at the moment that should be considered by the Privileges Committee, and that should come back to the government to as appropriate from the committee, as they see appropriate from the committee, to deal with what is a much more significant issue. And I think there are other steps that, frankly, should be contemplated between the government and the opposition in relation to what is a significant issue. Because, as the member for Watson pointed out, there are many people who come into this parliament with significant wealth on both sides of the parliament. And good luck to them, as the member for Watson pointed out. There are many members, as I look around, who don't have those deep pockets to defend a defamation trial, in some cases costing over $1 million. That's the reality.
Leader House can just pause just for those members interjecting. I will eject members interjecting under 94A. This is not a normal procedure where you feel you can make contributions against the standing orders. This is a rare matter, and I need to hear people in silence. The Leader of the House.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. So I think there is a sensible discussion to be had at the appropriate time between the government and the opposition to see what the appropriate next step might be for this parliament. I think it's a workplace entitlement issue, and I think it's a broader discussion that should be had, and we are, as a government, prepared to have that discussion. So, Mr. Speaker, I table the letter that I have on the 18th of October written to the Privileges Committee, and for the reasons I've detailed
by the Manager of Opposition Business be as agreed to, and I call the Honourable the Leader of the Opposition.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I rise to defend the existence of the Register of Pecuniary Interests, and I rise to defend this Parliament, this House of Representatives, and the integrity of this House, because I find it, quite frankly, extraordinary that the government would be in a position of rejecting a recommendation from the Speaker in granting precedence, as you have. I've been in the position of the Leader of the House and held that position for two terms of the Parliament. On no occasion would I have even considered rejecting a motion that was brought forward after the Speaker had given due consideration to whether precedence should be given. As far as I'm aware, and I'd be interested in the Leader of the House commenting about whether there was a time since Federation whereby we have the circumstance that the Leader of the House is contemplating this Parliament will conduct. Because since Federation, there has never been a time where the House has voted down a resolution after precedence was given in more than 120 years. That has never occurred. Why? Because the standing orders are very clear. The standing orders under 51D Part 1 say in order to grant precedence, you had to give consideration as to whether, and I quote the standing order, a prima facie case of contempt or breach of privilege has been made out. And you can only consider that after you consider number 2, which is the matter has been raised at the earliest opportunity. Mr. Speaker, you've given consideration to this, and there's been some commentary in recent times about the seriousness in which you take your job. And I've said publicly that you are an outstanding Speaker who has raised the conduct of this House, and that's in all of our interests, but it particularly assists the government to have a Speaker who does their job independently. The idea here that there is any doubt as to the facts are extraordinary. But what this motion from the member for Watson does is just ask that the committee consider these facts, consider them, and make a determination and a recommendation. It's not a conclusion. And what, in opposing this motion, the government is saying, don't even look at it. Just pretend, look away. As to something that is very serious. What we have here is that on June 1, the member for Pearce said that he would withdraw a defamation case against the ABC. On September 13, the member for Pearce updated his register addressing payments related to the defamation case. And it discloses part contribution of the payment of my fees by a blind trust, known as the Legal Services Trust. As a potential beneficiary, I have no access to information about the conduct and funding of the trust. But it's not a blind trust. He knows where the money's being invested. It's being invested in him, in what's a private legal matter. That's what a blind trust is. That's what the member for Wentworth, when he was in this Parliament, former Prime Minister, did, so that investments could be made on his behalf and they wouldn't know where it was being invested. It's being paid to his lawyers for a private legal matter. And it is a nonsense that the member for Pearce has no idea who donated to this trust, because how did they know where to put the money? How did they know? The GoFundMe page, the reference that the minister referred to, GoFundMe pages, people know it. They're public by definition on the internet. This, you had to know exactly how to donate money to this trust to benefit the member for Pearce. But the House doesn't know where the donations came from. The Australian public don't know where the money
money came from, and this cannot be allowed to stand. If it's allowed to stand, it renders redundant the processes of this Parliament whereby all of us cannot receive money from private interests for personal reasons without disclosing it. That's the basis of that sort of point one in stamping out corruption in this Parliament. Now, I make no assertion as to the member for Pearson, nor does this resolution. But if this resolution is not carried, then anyone can receive money from unknown sources into a so-called blind trust and never declare it. It renders all the things, including foreign donations and interference. Don't come in here and talk about national security again if you don't vote for this resolution, because you won't be taken seriously. Because this opens it all up to foreign interference in our politics. It opens it all up for corporate interests or individual interests to buy influence in this Parliament without anyone knowing. And at the moment, some people can try to buy influence. And we know that that gets disclosed. And people have lost their seats over those issues. We know that Senator Dastyari lost his seat in the Senate, as a result of a small amount. This is up to $1 million for the former first legal officer of the land, the Attorney General, who was responsible while he held that title, for introducing legislation to create a National Integrity Commission in this Parliament. Like, you couldn't make this up. You could not make this scenario up, whereby the government is going to vote against this. And I would say to the Leader of the House, who, in spite of the risk of receiving substantial criticism on social media, I have some regard for, think about what you are doing with this resolution. Because you are saying, notwithstanding the Speaker's ruling, you are saying that you're ignoring the fact that the Speaker has determined this prima facie case worthy of consideration. You're not preempting the deliberations of the Privileges Committee. You're saying that they can't even look at it in spite of the Speaker's determination, in spite of the fact that there is so much public anger about this. And the public out there think wrongly, that there is a lot more dodgy activity than there is. I think most people go into Parliament overwhelmingly on all sides out of the public interest. And that's why they do it. But we have to acknowledge that one of the reasons why I support a National Anti-Corruption Commission with teeth is that a whole lot of the public are really angry about these issues. And this will make them damn angry. And they have every right to be damn angry. If this Parliament is saying someone who was the first law officer of the land received donations of up to $1 million that he must know where they're from, but no one else has a right to know where they're from, and we won't even give consideration to that, that's okay. It's not okay. It's not okay. No one made the member for Pearce engage in this legal activity against the ABC. That was his decision. His decision. And he's entitled, under the rules of the Parliament, to seek donations, but he's not entitled to do it anonymously. He's not entitled to pretend that it is a blind trust when it is not. There is an absolute responsibility of every member of this House to support this motion to refer the member
has
in 2021.
The question is that the motion moved by the manager of opposition business be disagreed to. All those of that opinion say aye. To the contrary, no.
No.
The ayes have it.
No.
Division required. Ring the bells for 4 minutes. Lock the doors. Order. The question is the motion moved by the manager of opposition business be disagreed to. The ayes will pass to the right of the chair, the noes to the left. I appoint the honourable members for Nichols and Gray, Tellers for the ayes, and the honourable members for Werriwa and Lawler, Tellers for the noes.
Thank you.
Order. The result of the division is ayes 52, noes 49. The question is therefore resolved in the affirmative.
I am, Mr. Speaker. The member for Isaacs is accused exiting ministers of taking a bribe. It is completely unacceptable. It is completely unparliamentary. And I ask the minister to do the right shadow minister to approach the dispatch box and withdraw that.
I'll just say to the minister, if members can just control themselves for a second, I'm the arbiter of who comes to the dispatch box and who doesn't. I heard interjections, but I didn't hear the substance of them. That's what happens when members shout at each other as they're leaving the chamber. The manager of opposition business on the point of order.
On the point of order? What the House has just done is unprecedented.
Manager of opposition business, no, we're not going to go over.
No, but goes into exactly what he's just pointed to.
No,
voted that we'll never find out
the
if someone's
manager
right.
Of opposition business.
That's how he voted.
His seat. The manager of opposition business will resume his seat. The manager of opposition business will resume his seat. The member for McKellar will not stand at the back of the chamber and interject. And you will not scoff. You've got a seat, either sit in it or leave. I'm just going to ask the member for Isaacs to come to the dispatch box and ask whether he made an unparliamentary remark or reflected on members. The member for Isaacs.
I did, Speaker.
Well, I need the member for Isaacs to withdraw.
And I withdraw.
I thank the member for Isaacs. I've received advice from the Chief Government Whip nominating members to be members of certain committees. The Minister.
I ask leave of the House to move a motion for the appointment of members to certain committees.
Is leave granted? The Manager of Opposition Business.
So, can we have a copy of the list?
I want to know what I'm granting leave to.
We haven't got it, so we're not voting for it.
Well, we're not voting
for it unless you tell us what it is.
Well, there's two things. There's one that's granted, and the other is the question is put at the end. So, normally the practice is, I know. Tempers are a bit frayed, but normally leave is granted and then the minister has to move.
Mr. Speaker, I appreciate what normally happens.
Yep.
We've just had something happen that has never happened in the history of Federation that goes to a corruption issue. What normally happens...
Well, we won't keep debating the matter. Leave is either granted or it's not. All right. Leave is not granted. I now call the member for Mallee.